welcome to Poetry at the Dalí. Very happy to see your faces out there in the audience. I think you're in for a distinct evening of poetry. We're going to be doing something a little different this evening in that we're going to explore what's really a kind of new platform for poetry. And our evening will go essentially like this. Fortunately, there is a consistency. We will hear from, you will be welcomed, and our visiting poet, Todd Boss, will be introduced by Helen Wallace, Poet Laureate of New York. No. Did you recently? Of St. Petersburg, the New York of the South. And that's our consistent element, that Helen will, as is a signature part of our program, read a poem to begin. We're going to have about two-thirds of the program looking at this new medium for poetry, and then the last third, Todd will read from his poems in the traditional manner of reading from one's books of poems. So please welcome Poet Laureate of St. Petersburg, Helen Wallace.
Thank you so much, Hank, and thank you to all of you all for coming out again. And you know, we all know it's been a tough campaign season and a tough week, but fortunately for us, we are here in this beautiful place, in this amazing building, and have the opportunity to celebrate poetry, which I think probably everybody who's here knows has the gift of being able to bring people together. And so I will start out reading a short poem. It's a sonnet. And it has an epigraph from Audubon. And I think the only thing you need to know, there's a word, the title is Dapping on Black Lake, and dapping is the word for skipping stones. And some of you may or may not know that word, but that's something that was a childhood pastime of mine, maybe some of yours as well. Just for, I don't know, well, I like this epigraph because it kind of names it. It's sort of an act of defiance in some way, which is why it felt appropriate for tonight. This is called Dapping on Black Lake, and the epigraph goes like this. In that string of seconds when the stone defies natural law, we find a freedom which allows our minds to skip across the water in brief defiance. For us, I grip a gray flat stone, make a wish, fling it toward a lake, one dark and open as a heart. Gravity craves to be defied, like any law grown weary of itself, the order of things too unpredictable. I watch Flint skip across the pool, willing we could rid the world of pain that sends dark rings rippling out. A simple act of yearning, skipping stones. With luck and flair, much can be surpassed, like black ink flicked across a page, the stone burns a path, a blistering path, through deft air that will not let it sink. So we are in for a huge treat tonight. It is such a pleasure to have Todd Boss here with us. Wow, what a Renaissance guy. I told him when I picked him up today from the airport, you know, the more I read about him, the more I think there should be clones of him. There have to be more than just one to do all the many things that Todd does. He grew up on an 80-acre cattle farm in west central Wisconsin, where he helped his parents in a garden field and forest. And his 2008 poetry debut called Yellow Rocket was followed by Pitch in 2012 and Tough Luck, which is coming out in 2017. All from W.W. Norton and Company. Here's Yellow Rocket, and here's Pitch, and you can get them both over in our bookstore. I think the bookstore's open until 8 o'clock, and then Todd would be happy to sign some after the after the program today if you're interested. His poems have appeared in Poetry, American Poetry Review, The London Times, The New Yorker, NPR, Best American Poetry, and Virginia Quarterly Review, which called Yellow Rocket one of the year's 10 best poetry books, and awarded Todd the Emily Clark Balch Prize. Yellow Rocket was a finalist for the Minnesota Book Award and was named a Midwest Booksellers Honor Book for Poetry. Pitch was also a Minnesota Book Award finalist and won the Midwest Booksellers Choice Award. He's also a public artist. In a 2012 public art installation, he anchored, and I have to learn more about this, he anchored 35 oversized life rings in the Mississippi River in downtown Minneapolis to mark the fifth anniversary of the 35W bridge collapse. He paired the month-long installation with his 35-poem cycle, Fragments from the 35W Bridge, which the Star Tribune printed in its entirety on opening day. The project was a collaboration with the Swedish artist Maja Spasova. Todd's second installation was a monumental poetry film projection onto the entire block-wide facade of St. Paul's historic Union Depot. Wow. And it had its debut in 2014. He's also a librettist. His first evening-length song cycle, called Panic, a verse retelling of Knute Hamsun's 1986 novella Pan, premiered in spring 2014 by Boston Conservatory's Andy Vores. He also collaborates on choral texts frequently with the award-winning composer Jake Runstad. And he's a film producer, and we're going to see many of his films here tonight. He's the founding executive and artistic director of Motion Poems, the world's only poetry film company. Motion Poems' annual season of 20 to 15 film premieres annually at the Walker Arts Center in Minneapolis. He lives in Minneapolis, where he teaches at the Loft Literary Center and has served on the board of directors of 10,000 Things Theater Company. He's also been the artist in residence at the Target Studio at the Wyman Art Museum of the University of Minnesota. So please give a warm welcome to Todd Boss.
Thanks, man. Leave those up here. Thank you. Do you just want me to set? We didn't really go through this part of the evening. Should I just set up a little bit of what Motion Poems is?
Yes. You know, we might even start with, you know, trying to describe this medium, which has been variably called poetry and film, word videos, word TV, motion poems, and your platform, which is both production company and platform on the internet, provides a place for one to find these.
Right.
This new medium.
Yeah. I guess it all started about 8 years ago when I was giving a poetry reading in St. Paul. And a woman came up to me afterwards and introduced herself as a filmmaker and said, I'd like to turn one of your poems into a short animation. And of course, that sounded completely exotic and extraordinary. So, and I'm no dummy, so I said yes. And she went to work, and it was only a few weeks later that she had come up with something. And it was an animation, very brief, a minute or less. But the idea that my poetry or anybody's poetry could serve as a script for a filmmaker, fully realized film, was really intoxicating to me. And I know a lot of poets, and she knows a lot of filmmakers. So the idea was to bring other poets and filmmakers into this collaboration. I think tonight you're going to see maybe two of my own poems that we sort of cut our teeth on early in the process, just to sort of learn our way around what this kind of collaboration could look like, or maybe just one of my own.
More than that of yours.
Okay.
I think what we've set up, Todd, is that we're going to look at some like high benchmarks of the medium.
Great.
And in there's one of yours. We're going to look at Mark Strand, Billy Collins, and the Catherine Pierce piece that you have on your platform.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah, the Billy Collins piece wasn't one of ours, but the others are. And are we going to run through the whole program all in one swoop? Or
I thought we'd stop and talk about it in between.
Great, great. Does that sound okay to you? Oh, yeah. Okay, great. I think that's all there is to say. Maybe we should just jump into some.
Let's jump in with the first one, Mark Strand, The Mysterious Arrival of an Unusual Letter.
It had been a long day at the office and a long ride back to the small apartment where I lived. When I got there, I flicked on the light and saw on the table an envelope with my name on it. Where was the clock? Where was the calendar? The handwriting was my father's, but he had been dead for 40 years. As one might, I began to think that maybe, just maybe, he was alive, living a secret life somewhere nearby. How else to explain the envelope? To steady myself, I sat down, opened it, and pulled out the letter. Dear son, was the way it began. Dear son, and then nothing.
One of the wonderful parts of this new medium is that anything you can do in film, you can achieve here in the service of poetry. And the bookend, though, of credits is something new, because in poetry, we don't usually have a recitation of the production assistants. But for me, I love it because it gives you a chance to take a breath and absorb that incredible emotional impact from the closure instead of having to react immediately. It gives a nice breath.
I worked at the Playwright Center for about 5 years, which is a Minneapolis institution. We turn contemporary scripts into bona fide plays. They either fail or succeed in a workshop setting with real actors and real directors trying to figure out whether they work or not with the playwright. And I just love the idea that poets have scripts, too, that are ripe for interpretation. We all interpret poems. When we read them, we create films in our heads, whether we want to or not, whether we're conscious of it or not. And so I just love the notion of continuing to challenge poets to give up their work to other artists to interpret.
The next one we might see is one of my favorites. It's by Todd, and it's called The Trees Were Once Good Men.
The trees, they were once good men and good women who for whatever reason were never given the keys to heaven and who stand now, arms outstretched to one another. Some entangled, some even grown together, in more than solidarity, but still afraid to fall in love again. From these, in this thin stand here, one sees one's vulnerability, one's slender life, one's limbs lifted high. The air, sun-riddled goodbyes. The wood, listen, can you hear your deepest prayer? Your farthest flung flitter of shame, your heaviest sigh sung like a name? No, nor can I.
It's perfect for the Dalí Museum, isn't
it? I think we have to clap for that.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things I want to say about that one, and I would say it's about your work in general, Todd, that I love so much, is you can really hear his play with music, his use of internal rhyme and assonance and alliteration that's coming through so much. In these poems, I just think it's masterful the way that you're doing that while you're also giving the visual images.
Thanks. I love that about it. So. This next one, Billy Collins, really was the inspiration for us in some ways because he was doing this years ago. Film company producer contacted him and asked him if he could turn some of his poems into short films. And they made about 8 of them. You can find them all online at Billy Collins. It's bcactionpoet.com. BC, Billy Collins, actionpoet.com. And all these films are there. This is, I think, one of the best ones.
Let's see it.
Forgetfulness. The name of the author is the first to go, followed obediently by the title, the plot, the heartbreaking conclusion, the entire novel, which suddenly becomes one you have never read, never even heard of. It is as if one by one the memories you used to harbor decided to retire to the southern hemisphere of the brain, to a little fishing village where there are no phones. Long ago, you kissed the names of the 9 muses goodbye, and you watched the quadratic equation pack its bag. And even now, as you memorize the order of the planets, something else is slipping away, a state flower, perhaps, the address of an uncle, the capital of Paraguay. Whatever it is you are struggling to remember, it is not poised on the tip of your tongue, not even lurking in some obscure corner of your spleen. It has floated away down a dark, mythological river, whose name begins with an L, as far as you can recall, well on your own way to oblivion, where you will join those who have forgotten even how to swim and how to ride a bicycle. No wonder you rise in the middle of the night to look up the date of a famous battle in a book on war. No wonder the moon in the window seems to have drifted out of a love poem that you used to know by heart.
Wow, we love Billy Collins. The next one, a poem that motion poems turned into a film. This is a live action film. It's basically just the poet's address to a tornado.
Yeah.
I know I've already had more than I deserve. These lungs that rise and fall without effort. The husband who sets free house lizards. This red-doored ranch. My mother on the phone. That I can eat anything. Gouda, popcorn, Masaman curry. Without worry. Sometimes I feel like I've been overlooked. Checks and balances, and I wait for the tally to be evened. But I am a greedy son of a bitch. And there I know we are kin. Tornado, this is my child. Tornado, I won't say I built him, but I am his shelter. For months, I buoyed him in the ocean, on the highway. On crowded streets, I learned to walk with my elbows out. And now he is here. And he is new. And he is a small moon. An open face. A heart. Tornado, I want more. Nothing is enough. Nothing ever is. I will heed the warning protocol. I will cover him with my body. I will wait with mattress and flashlight, but know this. If you come down here, if you splinter your way through our pines, if you suck the roof off this red-doored ranch, if you reach out a smoky arm from my child, I will turn hacksaw. I will turn grenade. I will invent for you a throat and choke you. I will find your stupid, wicked, whirling head and cut it off. Do not test me. If you come down here, I will teach you about greed and hunger. I will slice you into palm-sized gusts. Then I will feed you to yourself.
Wow.
So beautifully and highly produced, and it shows the potential of bringing all of filmmaking's sophistication, sound and sets and professional actors into the service of terrific poetry. So I think this is a real benchmark too. Really congratulate Motion Poems on making that. It's fantastic.
Hank, do you want to set up the next, what's...
Sure.
You know better.
So,
about these.
You know, film has been of interest to artists as long as it's been around, and many of the surrealists got involved in making films, and they were always looking at some element of film that probably was not the necessarily ordinary storytelling aspect of film that became so popular. But in the 90s, there was a film director named Pellington and a producer named Bob Holmes who ran the New Yorican Poetry Cafe. Mm-hmm. And they got Pellington to use the... Pellington was a well-known, still is, a well-known director of commercials. You know, Procter & Gamble and really skilled. And he commissioned him to... do a series of poems, and they did a series that was broadcast. It was called The United States of Poetry in the 1990s. So we've selected just a few of those to give you a taste of this medium. And the first is one involving Lou Reed. So let's see that one.
Ooh. caught between the twisted stars, the plotted lines, the faulty map that brought Columbus to New York. Betwixt between the east and west, he comes to her with a leather vest. The earth screams and shudders to a halt. A diamond crucifix in his ear is used to help ward off the fear that he has left his soul in someone's rented car. Inside his pants, he hides a mop to clean the mess that he has dropped into the life of lithesome Juliet Bell. And Romeo had Juliet. Juliet had her Romeo. Romeo Rodriguez squares his shoulders, curses Jesus, runs his hands through his black ponytail. He's thinking of his lonely room, the sink that by his bed gives off a stink. And he smells the perfume in her hair, and her voice was like a bell. Outside, the streets are steaming, the crack dealers are dreaming of an Uzi someone had just scored. I bet you I can hit that light with my one good arm behind my back, says little Joey Diaz. Brother, give me another tote. Those downtown hoods are no damn good. Those Italians need a lesson to be taught. This cop who died in Harlem, you'd think they'd get the warning. I was laughing when his brains ran out in the street. I'll take Manhattan in a garbage bag with Latin writ on it that says it's hard to give a shit these days. Manhattan sinking like a rock to the filthy Hudson. What a shock. They wrote a book about it. They said it was like ancient Rome. And Romeo had Juliet. And Juliet had her Romeo. Perfume burns his eyes, holding gently to her thighs. And something flickered for a minute. And then it vanished and was gone.
Yeah, that was a Lou Reed poem and produced by this Bob Holmes and directed by Pellington. And you see that they wanted to use the celebrity name to tag it, which maybe wasn't necessary. But so this was an emergent art form and people were exploring. Let's look at the next one, John, also from the same series, from the 90s.
Democracy. It's coming through a hole in the air from those nights in Tiananmen Square. It's coming from the feel that this ain't exactly real, or it's real, but it ain't exactly there. From the wars against disorder, from the sirens night and day, from the fires of the homeless, from the ashes of the gay. Democracy is coming to the USA. It's coming from the sorrow in the street, the holy places where the races meet, from the homicidal bitchin' that goes down in every kitchen to determine who will serve and who will eat. It's coming to America first, the cradle of the best and of the worst. It's here they got the range and the machinery of change. And it's here they got the spiritual thirst. It's here the family's broken, and it's here the lonely say that the heart has got to open in a fundamental way. Democracy is coming to the USA. I'm sentimental, if you know what I mean. I love the country, but I can't stand the scene. And I'm neither left or right. I'm just staying home tonight, getting lost in that hopeless little screen. And I'm stubborn as those garbage bags that time cannot decay. I'm junk, but I'm still holding up this little wild bouquet. Democracy is coming to the USA. Sail on, Sail on, O mighty ship of state, to the shores of need, past the reefs of greed, through the squalls of hate. Sail on, sail on, sail on.
I didn't know how much we were going to need that one. Wow. Yeah. So there is one more from that series. And John Fisher, who has brought many of these from the web, you know, we can watch these beautifully on screen, but it's tough to get it up to this size because of the resolution. He's done a great job. He's back in the booth.
Thank
there.
Thank you, John. Yeah.
But this one's called Dilly Dally.
Businesswoman found dead in her apartment above. She has been abused by the correction staff and she has been abused by the correction.
Arise each dear. Yet another shock from this alarm clock culture, and I miss the sound of my big red cock as him beat him chest and crow welcome song to the sun from the foul shit covered guava tree on the hillside. The snooze button allow me 5 minutes more to dream about ackee and breadfruit. And I get up and eat a bagel and worry about my love handle. Well, I live in my building for 5 years now and my neighbors them still don't know me. Solace come from anonymity. And every time I bite the apple swallow me. The Korean, polish them apples them clean. And I arrange them in stacks of red, gold, and green. Same want Rasta to feel welcome. Seen. Still I yearn for the breeze from the not to be a sea as it cooled down the sweat by my back. I long to feed dry coconut to my cock. So I dilly. And I dally, and I wonder how much longer I can philander. Cause each time I bite the apple, it swallow a piece of me. Still it hard to love the fruit, but never to climb the tree.
This is my first time seeing two of the last three of those, and they're so reminiscent. You can draw the line really clearly from the rock video, the music video, yeah, which was ascendant in, you know, the 90s, 80s, right, and 90s, to these, where the poet is positioned as the hero of the film. What we tell motion poems takes kind of a different approach to that. What we tell filmmakers is that motion poems isn't the client, And the poet isn't the client. The poem is the client. So do everything you can, what we say is, do everything you can in making this film to please the poem. And don't worry about anybody else. The poem, the text becomes the hero of the piece that way, I think, as opposed to, it's not an aesthetic exactly, it's just, it's a value maybe that's apparent in everything that motion poems does.
That sounds really useful to your directors to do. Mm-hmm.
I have a question. What, sort of the chicken and the egg question, is the poem comes first and is it
yeah.
written purely as a poem, not with the vision
of a video in mind? Right, that's right. We're taking already published poems in almost every case, poems that themselves were just written to be, you know, page poems, and giving them over to filmmakers and allowing them to completely go crazy without any artistic direction whatsoever. We introduce them to their poet early in their process, just to open the gates of communication between the two of them, because you'd be surprised, but filmmakers are often scared to death to contact poets.
Many people
should be the other way around, you'd think, but it goes the other way too. And we facilitate a 15-minute conversation just to, you know, open that relationship. But anything beyond that is really up to the filmmaker to take from there. So it's not a true collaboration in every sense of the word. Are we moving on?
Sure, let's go on. Now this group, you know, are not completely distinct, but there seems to be an emphasis on text, on visualizing the text in the context of the film. So this next one is by Todd, and it's called Don't Be Flip.
Don't be flip when you drop your mate at the dock or your children at school. Don't be cool. Don't be coy. Or if you do, don't assume it's okay to act that way. For today may be your last chance at joy before it flashes away. Like a tin toy in one of those shooting galleries in Midway's, those ducks that seem to paddle a stream that's not a stream but a rotating axle, toothed for disappearance and reappearance, a spit without point or flame, along which randomly clucks the whole game.
That's really lovely.
So Todd, you didn't see any of that until it was actually finished.
Right.
So you gave him the poem.
And it's a shock, you know, when you first see it. And I always prepare our poets who work with us that you probably won't like the finished film at first. It's just a shock to see it reimagined by someone else who sees it completely differently than you do. But after subsequent viewings, all our poets learn to love their films, and pretty soon they're sharing it with all their friends. Mm-hmm. Hank, you did these next two,
yes.
Right?
I did these next two. I just wanted to comment on this one, though. I just love the simplicity of the moral instruction. It's just, it's so useful, and using film, which usually feels burdened with telling a dramatic story, sometimes violent, you know, using a whole range of scenes is done with these simple images and animations and delivers this, I think, very friendly advice to all of us. I really love that one. Now, I've been working in this medium for a while, but my productions are, you have to understand, are highly domestic. I just use, now I'm using, you know, the phone camera, but I used to just have a home video and the laptop and put things together. So this first one is, I was reading an essay of Aristotle on memory at the same time that my daughter was growing up and ready to go to college. So I was going through some old photos and put things together and asked her to read from this essay. So you'll see.
Our task is now to discuss memory and remembering. What it is, why it occurs, and to what part of the soul this affection and that of recollection belongs. For it is obvious that one must consider the affection which is produced by sensation in the soul and in that part of the body which contains the soul. The affection, the lasting state of which we call memory, as a kind of picture. Cool, but not. Yeah. Is this a run through?
This is a trial, go ahead.
No, I don't want to
okay,
try.
Okay, this is for real.
Yeah. Our task is now to discuss memory and remembering. What it is, why it occurs, and to what part of the soul this affection. What? But memory is of the past. No one could claim to remember the present while it is present. For instance, one cannot remember a particular white object while one is looking at it.
Completely terrible. You hadn't even looked at the words in the thing, so you don't know them. Cognize. And
because I don't have any obligation to do this. You're so annoying, like you're a little ungrateful. A little bit. Hey, your essay sucked, just so you know.
Thank you.
Memory is neither sensation nor judgment, but is a state or affection of one of these when time has elapsed. There can be no memory of something now present at the present time, as has been said. But sensation refers to what is present, expectation to what is future, and memory to what is past. All memory, then, implies lapse of time. First, then, we must comprehend what sort of things are objects of memory, for mistakes are frequent on this point. It is impossible to remember the future, which is an object of conjecture or expectation. Nor is there memory of the present, but only perception, for it is neither the future nor the past that we cognize by perception, but only the present. If memory really occurs in this way, is what one remembers the present affection or the original from which it arose? If the former, then we could not remember anything in its absence. If the latter, how can we, by perceiving the affection, remember the absent fact which we do not perceive? This would imply that one can also see and hear what is not present. But surely, in a sense, this can and does occur.
That's a remarkable study in humor and the way the outtake can change up our expectations of what narrative or the literature usually can deliver.
I thought it was refreshing to hear that Aristotle's essay sucked.
I'm sure she'd be thrilled to know that you're showing that in your museum tonight. But then there's also something very affecting about the very personal nature of this. It's a scrapbook, as you say, of not found objects, but treasured objects,
yeah.
Treasured films. Yeah. That it just feels like a door opening into the filmmakers, in your case, you, mine.
And, you know, we regret that there's not, you know, wasn't higher production quality, because we're so used now to seeing things just crystal clear and the sound beautiful, and but I think there's room for this use of film as poetry in a domestic context. And the next one is one that doesn't have any sound. It's just using the fact that video scores in time to deliver the message in time.
When were these done?
This one's about 10 years old, the one we just saw, and this other one's more recent. So, see this next one.
That's so lovely because of the way that it, well, it's lovely for a lot of reasons. There's the pacing of it, that we're forced to pace ourselves with you in the cadence that you would maybe read it.
I think that's our one of the avenues as poets is that we give someone a book and they will read it as they've been taught to read. Mm-hmm. Maybe they'll pause at the end of the line. Maybe they'll scan, you know, quickly. Maybe they'll go slowly. But we can determine that with this medium. We can say, here's how it is. It goes like this.
Yeah. You have a question?
Well, on that note, I would say that the number one thing that seems to me like all these films are doing is putting a voice to the poetry. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, what you're calling narrative poetry is really imagistic poetry. You're putting images on it. Mm. But as opposed to the whole history of real narrative poetry.
Right.
I mean, there's a whole history of real narrative poetry.
Right.
And that's not here. But it seems to me like, poetry is sound, and just putting a great voice on a poem is such a treat, and having people listen to it. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the number one thing that I see these poems doing, and or in the case of the last one, as you said, creating a cadence through the pacing of the words. Mm-hmm. It's also very nice just to see the words, you know, that...
Especially for word lovers, we love them.
So now we're going to explore a couple more of Todd's.
We're almost done. There's only four films left.
And then you're going to read your work.
So this one is called "My Love for You Is So Embarrassingly."
My love for you is so embarrassingly grand. Would you mind terribly, darling, if I compared it to the Hindenburg? I mean, before it burned? That vulnerable, elephantine dream of transport, a fabric titanic on an ocean of air. There, With binoculars, dear, you can just make me out in a gondola window, wildly flapping both arms as the ship's shadow moves like a vagrant country across the country where you live in relative safety. I pull that oblong shadow along behind me wherever I go. It is so big and goes so slowly, it alters ground temperatures noticeably, makes housewives part kitchen curtains, rings whimpers from German shepherds. Aren't I ridiculous? Isn't it anachronistic, this dirigible devotion, this Zeppelin affection, a moon that touches with a kiss of wheels the ground you take for granted beneath your heels.
Built from photos on an old farm by the filmmaker and animated from photos. Mm-hmm. It's about the growing up on a farm in Wisconsin. I wrote it about the old windmill that I grew up with as a boy.
The god of our farm had blades and a rudder. All our acres begged its pardon. Merest breezes made its rusty flower turn and whine and shudder. Its wooden arm a weathered stump. The god of our farm no longer pumped the well that still it lorded power over. It belonged to another order. On silent nights in summer, windows open, many times its vocal powers found me deep in dreams and hauled me up. Unearthly alarm. What ache. How the vein would groan, the rotor churn, and with what moan when a good gust came. It scared me to the bone, as if some inner tower of my own for an unknown water yearned.
And then just last year, Ann Eichler-Kolakowski came to our attention with a little triolet that she had written for Laika, the first dog in space. I think we saw it in Poetry Magazine. And so we delivered that to filmmakers. And this is the next film that you'll see. Thank you.
Todd, picking up on something you said earlier about the director serving the poem, I think this is an example of the filmic dimension making so much more of the poem. And I would ask you to think about, you know, the dog is always a metaphor for devotion, dog-like devotion. Hmm. But he's personified as a person on a mission. So you get this compound sense of person and animal.
Yeah.
And it's not there in the language.
Yeah.
So I think this is a wonderful example of bringing something, a dimension of feeling and import that's much grander through this medium.
I agree with you. I don't understand that, how that works. But there's a level of absurdity to that image that rubs against our understanding of dogs and people, but plays on both of them. There's a cognitive dissonance throughout that piece, just watching that character from frame to frame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever taken then one poem and had three different filmmakers interpret the same poem?
We've done that a couple of times with a couple of different pieces. Had we a longer evening, I might show you some of the results of that. It's always interesting. What it does, is, to my mind, is illustrate just how differently any one of us sitting here might read the same poem, you know.
Todd, what advice might you have for poets in the audience who want to play around with this? Are there particular poems that lend themselves more to this this pairing than others?
The answer to that question is, I think, no. To the narrative point that you made earlier, you know, you'd think that it would be better to pick a really narrative poem, but I don't think that's the case. Mm-hmm. And filmmakers see, you know, their own things in poems. So I guess my only advice, if you wanted to try something like this, is to contact a filmmaker just right here in your own community, or somebody who wants to give this a try, even on a very amateur basis. Maybe Hank, ask him to turn one here. and just see what results, because that's basically how Motion Poems was started.
If you write poetry for film, is it still poetry?
Yeah, good question. And are we doing a terrible disservice to poetry by interpreting it this way on the screen?
No, we're not.
We very well might be. So this last one is Aaron Ballou, a poem that we just love, and I show it everywhere I go. When at a certain party in New York City, it's called.
Wherever you're from sucks, then wherever you grew up sucks. Then everyone here lives in a converted chocolate factory or deconsecrated church without an ugly lamp or souvenir coffee cup in sight. But only carefully edited objets like the Lacanian soap dispenser in the kitchen that looks like an industrial age dildo. When you rifle through the bathroom looking for a spare tampon, you discover that even their toothpaste is somehow more desirable than yours. And later you go with a world-famous critic to eat a plate of sushi prepared by a world-famous chef from Sweden, and the roll is conceived to look like a strand of pearls around a white throat and is so confusingly beautiful that it makes itself impossible to eat. And your friend back home, who says the pioneers who first settled the great asphalt parking lot of our middle were not in fact heroic, but really the chubby ones who lacked the imagination to go all the way to California? It could be that she's onto something, because admit it. When you look at the people on these streets, the razor blade women with their strategic bones and the men wearing Amish pants with interesting zippers, it's pretty clear that you will never cut it anywhere that constitutes a wear. That even ordering a pint of tuna salad in a deli is an illustrative exercise in self-doubt. So when you see the dogs in the high-rise elevators practically tweaking, panting all the way down from the 19th floor to the first, dying to get on with their long-planned business of snuffling trash or peeing on something to which all day they've been looking forward, what you want is to be on the fastest Conestoga home. where the other losers live, and where the tasteless azaleas are, as we speak, half-heartedly exploding.
So that's our show. Do you want to do some question and answer, or how do you want to, what do you want to do?
What I would love is if you'd move into reading.
Yeah,
and,
sure.
You know, I think that if you read The God of Our Farm Has Blades to start, because we just...
You want to hear it again?
We just saw it and heard it.
Sure.
And maybe we could answer that question about disservice or...
Right. Well, now you see, now you've got that image in your
yes.
head. So we've already done you the disservice of showing you the film. The God of Our Farm Had Blades and a Rudder. All our acres begged its pardon. Merest breezes made its rusty flower turn and whine and shudder. Its wooden arm a weathered stump, the god of our farm no longer pumped the well that once it lorded power over. It belonged to another order. On silent nights in summer, windows open, many times its vocal powers found me deep in dreams and hauled me up. Unearthly alarm, what ache. How the vein would groan, the rotor churn, and with what moan when a good gust came. It scared me to the bone, as if some inner tower of my own for an unknown water yearned. This one, if you like that, you'll like this one too. This is called Broke. This is about, you know, growing up on a farm in Wisconsin. We broke horses, broke calves of their mother's milk. Broke our hands herding heifers, broke axes and hammers right off their hafts, broke bread with thanks, broke bank accounts, broke our backs over banks of taters and beets, broke beets from their greens, broke peas from their pods, broke the silence of night with a little something spoke, broke necks of mice that got in our traps, broke the ice in the tank so the stock could drink. Broke chickens with a twist of fists. Broke their yolks into breakfasts. Broke wide our wallets for the offering plate. Broke the stitching on our Bible's spines. Broke harsh north winds with lines of pines. And then, when all was said and done, we broke the bonds of earthly toil when by our work we'd been broke down and over the soil that mended where we lay, there ended one, then broke another day.
Wow.
You've been a very sweet audience. I'll leave you with that. Do you want more poems? I don't want to keep you much longer. You've been a really great audience. I'll just read two or three more and then let you go. You've been very patient.
And they may have some more questions after that.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So keeping on the farm poems vein, I'm reading from Pitch. There's a piano on the front of this book, and it's because I like to write about my parents' mistakes. And much to their chagrin. And one of the things that I experienced as a 12-year-old was when my father brought the family piano home from my grandfather's home, his father's house, and lost it over the back of the pickup truck corner near our farm. So this poem recounts that experience. It's called Overtures on an Overturned Piano. And it's got four sections, but I'll just read you the first one. From farm to farm, and one more midnight mile to go, my father took too fast the last turn on black ice, and presto, over the side of our half-ton Ford and into the drainway went my father's brother's turn of the century Steinway piano. My mother's scream out-screamed the Weatheralls. She cursed Weatheralls. You probably don't know what Weatheralls are. All-season tires. All right. My mother's scream out-screamed the Weatheralls. She cursed him again, cursed him in the worst way, and then cursed him in the first way again. As we careened around in a sudden Y and our high beams played across the gleaming bed of snow-drifted bramble where it lay, moaning chaotically in every key, miraculously intact. Yes, miracles happen, only scratched, in fact, one foreleg broken. And part of me still sits on that bench seat as if on a line above the stave, top heavy with gravity and levity alike, twisted, peering, wake-eyed through the melt blear scrawled across the rear glass, trying to pound it into my head, the broken cords, the empty bed. While she let go, winter did, her sheets and sheets of December, and started in on January instead.
Mm.
Little poem about my mother. She hates this poem. My parents always have first right of refusal on all my poetry, so they allow these to be in the book, which I think is courageous. This is called Were I to Wring a Rag, and it's just a single sentence. This is just a portrait of my mother. Were I to wring a rag, no matter how much muscle I might have mustered, my mother was like to come around behind me from... Were I to wring a rag, no matter how much muscle I might have mustered, my mother was like to come along behind me, reach around me to take it up again from where I'd left it, lift it back into my line of vision, and in one practiced motion from that strangle in her bare hands and thin air, work a second miraculous stream of silver dishwash into the day's last gleam. I'll just leave you with one more poem. It's called Apple Slices. It was on a splendid table. You know that National Public Radio broadcast? It was commissioned by them. It's just a memory of my work with my father, summers, when he was a construction worker, and he would sometimes have me help him on the job site. Apple slices. Apple slices eaten right off the jackknife in moons, half moons, quarter moons, and crescents. Still some in common summer afternoons I spent as my dad's job site grunt, framing future neighbors' houses out of 2x4s and 4x6s, and our brief and silent pickup tailgate lunchbox lunch breaks of link sausage, longhorn cheddar, larder pickles, cold leftover roast beef and butter sandwiches wrapped in paper, and a couple of pippins from the Fall Creek pick and save, and flavored of tin from the lip of the cup of a dented thermos passed between us, a hard-earned share of still chill well water. Now, so many waned and waxed moons later, another well-paid, well-fed, college-bred paper pusher, I wonder that I've never labored harder nor eaten better. Mm. Thanks for asking me to read.
Yes, please. She's going up.
Thank you for having me, Helen. You've been a great chauffeur and host
treat
for me today. And Hank, thanks for the private tour of the museum. It's a gorgeous space, and I hope to come back tomorrow and really absorb it. Thank you for being such a great audience.
Are you
do you
want to
do
a
Q&A?
Okay,
sure.
Okay, yeah.
Okay.
If anybody has some, either about
stay with her.
Okay.
The poems that he that are just in his book or about the film. The video
yeah.
poem. So yeah, back here.
I have a friend who is working with Claudia Rankine on a theater production of Citizen. And I'm wondering, given your background, if you've considered expanding the form to...
Yeah, who's doing it?
Pete Carroll. He's at Emerson College in Boston.
In Boston.
Yeah.
And is he a playwright, or what's his background?
A dramaturg.
Wow, awesome. I want to know more about it. But yeah, my early training in college was as a, I had a double major in English and speech theater. And of course, my work at the Playwright Center, I have a great deal of respect for playwriting. I think it is one of the most difficult of literary arts. And yeah, that sounds like a really worthy project. The question was whether... Yeah, and we've been approached by, I'm going to blank on the name of it. There's a little theater company in New York that does poems adapted for the stage. It'll come to me. What?
Fractured Atlas?
No, that's the insurance. Yeah, something like that, though. It'll come to me. Anyway, it sounds intoxicating, and I haven't been to see any of their productions. But yeah, I don't know that motion poems is situated to strategically go there. It's certainly a passion of mine. I'd love to.
Would you consider writing for the theater?
Yeah.
In your spare time. Yeah. Other questions? Yes, Gloria.
I have been following motion poems for a very long time, probably since like 2009.
Great.
I'm like so impressed with what it's become, truly. It's awesome.
Thanks.
And I've been teaching creative writing for 6 years to university students, and one of their assignments is to make a motion poem.
Yeah, great.
My intro students always make the best creative pieces, I think, because they are willing to take the most risks.
Yeah.
The least trained, I guess. And I find that lyric poetry, for some reason, is very much enhanced by the motion poem, and very much sort of brought to life, like lyric poetry and just imagery for students. I guess my question is, like, is there any kind of arm or something in the works in the future for student poets, kind of like a workbook or something, on how to approach it.
Yeah. We just got an NEA, a small NEA grant to develop curriculum guides for some of our work. So if you go to AWP, you'll see us at AWP giving out free classroom guides. That's a great question. you know, part of for me, the part of the joy of this, and you have your own reasons, but I love how film is a kind of indulgence. It's sort of unabashed. Film will lavish. We're gonna go right off the edge of the stage. It'll be fun. Film isn't afraid to sort of lavish on a text, lavish images, lavish voices. Lavish eyelashes, lavish text, lavish music. And so it's, to some extent, it's just really fun to have poetry be lavished upon, you know. And I think we as lovers of poetry do that in our personal reading, but it's nice to have other artists collaborate to do that.
Yes, Shane.
Were you involved in your motion picture to your poems you just read?
Yeah.
And then, because they were two remarkably different experiences. Mm. That thing was showing, and you reading
them. I want to hear more about that. What
was... I'm going to disagree with Hank here a little bit. I found your reading of it blew me away, whereas with your reading and that, felt like my mind was kind of having to shift back and forth. I really fell into it when you read it.
That's a really common, I've battled that in my mind, that when you're presented with such rich text, at the same time as you're presented with so much else that's rich, the imagery and the music, it's really hard to take in all at once. I applaud you for sitting through all of this straight through. When I see a motion poem, I have to always see it two or three times before I can really appreciate it. Mm. So it's hard to show them as one-offs like this in sequence. I agree with you.
Well, I wonder, in part, would it have to do with how the filmmaker approaches it, because just mm-hmm. like with poetry, the silences we create by allowing them to be there and not fill in every word, so our readers can kind of enter into our lines. I mean, a filmmaker, I would think, could do the same thing by making it a little more disjunctive and and kind of having more pauses.
Were you theater trained? Did you have any theater training at all?
No.
Yeah, in theater, you learn how to sort of inhabit the line and deliver it very, very presently. The idea isn't the words so much as it is using the words to connect with where the audience is psychically, you know, find that space and really deliver to them. Like I'm doing right now, we're communicating. and I think as poets, sometimes we forget that what we're doing is that. And instead we're serving the page, and that can be really problematic too.
Yes.
So maybe there are two ends of the spectrum.
Hank, do you want to answer that as well? What are your thoughts on or elaborate on your earlier thoughts?
Well, I'm very happy to hear the idea that poems by themselves can carry fully and effectively. I think that, you know, the more we depart from an oral tradition where we're trained to listen, and the more we depart from song in our poems, it's hard to get them. Now, for the gods of our farm had blades. I think there's an ambiguity there that may be intended. When you hear it, you don't know whether we're to think of the blades as the kind of blades that are dangerous on the street. But when you see the mill turning, you immediately get it. So I think of the film as an aid to apprehending the language. Mm. And I would love it if we could just rejoice in the beauty of the words, but I think for some reason we need more.
So it made me think that I know it's Aristotle who says the essence of poetry is metaphor. And maybe with film, if you're filling in too many gaps, if you present too much narrative in the in the picture themselves, then there's not the room for the reader or the watcher to make those metaphorical leaps with you as a poet. I don't know.
We have a couple of sheets of best practices that we present to all our filmmakers when they sign on to us. And one of the best practices that we identify is not to take the poem too literally or present it too literally.
That's what I'm talking about, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. The most successful films, motion poems and poetry films are the ones that layer metaphor on metaphor and build out.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Other questions? Anyone? Yes?
Well, I don't have a question, as much as a request. Is there some way that we can get a list of some of these shorts that we saw?
Yeah.
I'd like to share it with some of our friends who weren't here.
Sure.
And to let them know, I think, look at this. This is what we saw and what you missed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. Well, it'll be on the Dalí website.
The whole list? Awesome.
Yeah. And then I would also go to www.motionpoems.com.
You know,
right.
Or am I wrong?
I can get that to you, Sonia. No problem. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just through some of the question and dialogue, you know, just for the sake of, you know, inclusivity, if you will, it's not an either or question. You know, we don't have to figure out which we prefer. The beauty is that it's all available to us. So, narrative, wonderful. You know, just read, and when, you know, when you're reading and being able to see it in my own mind's eye, that's so powerful. I love to be read to, and I'm grateful to have it done often. But how wonderful to see also moving film. There's so much bad film in the world. and since Hank has introduced a lot of this to me recently, to see some of this, you know, the shorts in film, and to have it be moving and meaningful is so nice, instead of just seeing what. So I don't think, I just want to offer that.
Yeah,
one's
absolutely.
It doesn't have to be better.
Thanks,
It's all available.
Absolutely, that's a really good point. George,
Tom, like,
sorry.
It seems like every poem is different and requires certain effects. Some need to be left alone to kind of capture the space between the words, or just have that type of interpretation, where others can take the layering of images and all different types of sound effects and little mini movies, so to speak. But some seems like that would be, that you would be interfering with the language. So it's all a question of, I guess, in the mind's eye.
Right.
One would work for one, may not work for the other.
Right, I went to...
It's both. It's both what Hank is talking and what he is talking.
It really is, it boils down to interpretation, unfortunately, or adaptation, where somebody who went to one of our screenings once said it's like going to a poetry reading and opening a door in the back of the person's head who's sitting right in front of you and just seeing the poetry reading through their imagination. And I think that's a really interesting way to think about it. It's just one person's way of hearing the poem.
Any other questions?
Did you have something?
Did I? That kind of answered it, because I'm mixed. I'm so enthused, and I'm still very enthused to come see this, because it's been sort of a dream of mine, and I love that artists are collaborating. I'm just curious, because I do, in a way, find it distracting from the words and readings.
Yeah.
I'm so used to reading the poems, and then you have the visuals, but I love the visuals, so I'm kind of, my mind's all over the place. It's just like, because I want to see my own mind, like I'm envisioning the words as I read. Does that make sense?
Sure.
And like, am I misinterpreting? And I think I really felt like on the very first one, I'm like, well, this is just all laid out for me.
Right.
But then when I watched yours, is it Entangled? Is that the one? Is it the second?
The trees.
The trees?
The trees one.
Which one? I'm sorry if I'm...
That's okay.
But that, because it was so much imagery, and so that wasn't as distracting because the images that were involved in that, and it was gorgeous. Mm. And then with the Billy Collins one, which there was humor in it, but it wasn't, like, I was wondering, am I misinterpreting this? Because it seems like it should have been a little bit more dark humor, and there was a sadness to it that I feel like, if, had I been reading that on the page,
right,
I would have got that more. And I knew I was getting it, but at the same time, I'm laughing, but there's an absolute sadness to that poem.
Yeah.
You know, and
right.
I think that was kind of missed, you know, as we're watching it, you know?
Well, partly his voice is full of whimsy and resolve to the process of forgetfulness. So you weren't allowed to really be too sad.
I think you're right. There's another really wonderful one by Billy Collins, The Country.
The Country.
Yeah, if you can find that if you Google Billy Collins, The Country.
Or In the Country.
Yeah,
one of them.
It's terrific. Check that out when you get home.
Todd, can we talk about the audience for a moment? Do you have metrics for motion poems? This and The Grander.
No metrics, no.
So you don't know how many hits you get on the website?
Well, we have some data, I guess. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
30,000 on YouTube here, another 15,000 there, another 5,000 here.
Is that a monthly?
Aggregate.
So in the publishing industry, a run of 10,000 books would accrue to what writer? Did Mark Strand or... Well, Billy Collins would have had 10,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
Run of 10,000, maybe more. 20,
mm-hmm.
but 30? I mean, the point I'm making is that one of the virtues of this medium is that you make this accessible to an audience
in
an immediate and grand way. And that serves poetry.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And a question that we've talked about a little bit is what to do with this? I mean, it's such a cool hybrid. And you all know, because I know many of you have been back several times for this Dalí poetry series, that we're trying hard to bring together several different types of art here. So what are some things that we could do with this to try to weave poetry into the fabric of our
asking.
Community?
Wow, yeah. You can contribute financially. Can I say that? You can get involved. There's a lot of ways to get involved. Motion Poems is still very much a small innovative little startup, a nonprofit startup. So we're still kind of getting our legs and figuring out what we're capable of doing. Can I tell you a couple of things that we're working on?
Please.
We're working on 12 films right now commissioned by the Poetry Foundation for children.
Cool.
Films that were written by Children Poet Laureate and Caldecott winners and, you know, other great American poets writing for children and non-American writers. We're working on five films, kind of like the old ones that you saw from the United States of Poetry, where that position the poet as the rock star in their own video. And these are going to concentrate on spoken word artists. Just we're starting with five, just right in Minneapolis, St. Paul, written by local artists to us. I'm also working on a VR project. I want to make a poem that you can experience with a virtual reality headset on a moving platform. So what we've done is collaborated with the Minneapolis-St. Paul Metro Transit. We have a Green Line light rail that goes from Minneapolis to St. Paul. And we're going to start next summer unveiling just three rides, but we want to build a 23-ride experience in year two. Year one will just be three rides. You'll get on the train, you'll don a headset, and as soon as the train starts to move, the world will fall away in your vision, and you'll be able to transport yourself to, it'll be, you know, a whole virtual world. And the poetry will be discoverable as you go. It won't be dictated to you. One of the scenes, for example, has Father Nature sitting down in the seat next to you and falling asleep against your shoulder with his journal open, and he's been writing a love poem to humanity, and you can discover that, or you can look around into the rest of the world. So, the idea was sort of inspired by we're working with USC Film School, University of Southern California in Los Angeles. They have something called the World Building Lab, and that's they build 3D and virtual reality worlds. And the head of the World Building Lab said to me that this VR medium is so different from film in that you inhabit it, you live in it, and you can kind of create, you can construct your narrative depending on where you put your attention. So it's, he said, much more akin to poetry than it is to narrative storytelling. A really interesting comment from the World Building Lab.
Todd told me about this earlier, and I said, you know, wouldn't it be cool if we did that on our ferry? Between St. Pete and Tampa, a water-based VR.
Yeah, let's do it.
I think it'd be great.
Do you have a comment?
Is there a grant writer on staff?
Would you like to be one?
Years ago, perhaps, but not now.
I'm the grant writer, unfortunately, and we are looking for somebody to help us. So right. If you know of anybody.
Mm-hmm. Any other
questions?
I'll
think about it.
Thank you.
I just want to say one last thank you also to Hank. You know, how lucky we are to have him here as the executive director of this museum, but also as a poet and a graphic artist and all of the above, and what you bring to discussions like this is just really wonderful. Thank you, Hank.
Pleasure.
And thank you to Todd. Get some books in the bookstore.
The book signing, yes.
Yeah.
Kat, where is that going to be? Do you know?
Right outside the theater.
Yeah. All right. And there are books for sale.
Yes. And
Todd expressed his willingness to sign his name to them with a Sharpie.
Where's my Sharpie?
Excellent.
Yeah, I do.
Thank you all for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's really fun.
Good. Thank you for doing that. That was a beautiful program.